say the applicant, if they know the wrong captain, say.
And also, a couple of people told me that their grandparents found that there was quite a few Islamic belief, persons who believed it in Islam. But they hid it from the Christian church. Mm-hmm. Just pretended they were Christians. Really influenced by Islam.
Is there anything to do with the mixture of the Africans in the Bahamas with the smaller amount of people directly from Africa versus the Creoles and the slaves from the United States, and that there was a skewing towards the majority of our ancestors before they came with the royalists.
And they had
a
Christian background.
By the time they already had a Christian background.
They had already been pre-alized.
Yeah.
There were 10,000 of emancipation slaves and liberated Africans. We had about
6,000,
just over 6,000. So Creolized slaves were in the background.
David Baptist was a big influence between the loyalist coming and the English Baptist coming in the
1800s.
There was 20 societies of the native Baptists. That's it.
I was of the opinion that was the case, and I was going to express that same opinion that was given. But there was also another aspect. Because we were a lot of islands, there were a lot of European types coming here by boats, and they got married to many of those liberated women and in the over the hill area. That may, and therefore they influenced them in Christian religion to some extent.
But wasn't the segregation a crime?
I wonder if you could speak more to the role of women. You mentioned a few women who were prominent and wealthy, and that the men gathered under the cotton tree. What was the socializing ages for the women at the time as you grew up?
As a young boy, a woman's place was always in the home. There were few women who actually went out to work. You had some outstanding ladies like this Mrs. Lang, who operated a shop on the corner of Lewis Street and Market Street, and as also did Nora Thompson and Bill Moore. But women generally were not prominent in any of the professional or working areas. And that's a feature which has only come about in the last 20, 30 years. I would say post Second World War.
So I want to thank you for that wonderful walk down memory lane for your presentation.
Yes.
I was born in 1950, so I'm a generation after you. So I'm old, young enough to know some of what you experienced, but old enough not to experience some of the things you experienced. So thank you very much. You mentioned the newspaper called The Voice. Was there one called The Torch by the Citizens Committee?
The Torch was a political newspaper put up by Lebanon.
Do you remember much about the Citizens?
Yes.
Could you tell us a teeny bit about that?
The Citizens Committee had its birth as a result of a group of men forming themselves into a small unit to protest a decision which was taken by the Film Censorship Committee of the day, banning a showing of No Way Out, which was Sidney Poitier's first film. And as a result of all the protests and all that they did, this film was allowed to be shown here. And so effective was the work of the Citizens Committee in that case that they decided to stay as a unit and to do that kind of civic progress or achieve things which they should in the political area. And it was headed by Max Thompson, Maxwell J. Thompson, Randall Fox, Kendall Isaacs,
Freddie Martin is still Freddie Martin.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I noticed absent from your talk was any reference to the relationship of communities during the war years. For instance, we all know about what led to the, or we read about what led to the Burma Road riots. But you know, that sort of violent episode, there must be more to it than what we have read, and since it was in your era, in your time.
I don't know, but I know all the facts behind what led to the Burma Road. Dr. Gail-san probably can do a better job in answering you, but as I understand it, the official reason, or the reason which came out in the Commission of Inquiry, which was held afterwards, was that it had to do with the fact that the Pleasantville Corporation, an American company, which was engaged to build the airport and to rebuild Oaksfield, but to build the what is now International Airport, was being built as being developed as a war base. The RAF had been stationed here during the war, and bomber planes were developed by a company in Canada and sent here to be tested, and for the pilots and bombardiers to be trained on these planes around our waters. And as a result of which, there were one or two crashes in our water, before being ferried by an outfit called the Ferry Command across to the African theater of war. The Pleasantville Corporation, which had the contract, which was a joint American government and British government contract, had to engage local persons as well. And this was supposedly orchestrated by the Duke of Windsor, who was then our governor of the colony. But it turned out that the local workers at the base were being paid at an hourly rate which was higher than the Americans who came in to do the same work. And when they found out, they protested, and it wasn't true.
The Americans paid more than the locals.
They had a meeting, and leaders.